Duquel
yeah. Ok. So.
Yesterday, we recalled the basic definition of what is a category and the monoidal category, and what is functor, monoidal functor, natural transformation, and natural transformation between monoidal functor. So we finish by giving some example. Here, so two examples of monoidal functor between category coming from group. Here, an example of natural transformation. Between a monoidal category coming from a monoid. So you just take the category of S-graded vector spaces where S is a monoid. And we consider the identity as a monoidal functor, where the monoidal structure is just trivial. And in fact, we state that we consider the monoidal transformation, the natural transformation between this monoidal functor. And it's an exercise to show that it is completely determined by a monoid morphism from S to the field. So a priori, you can get something non-trivial. So it's a way to make a non-trivial natural transformation between a monoidal functor. Okay. Now, what about monoidal functor between the two twisted G-graded vector space? So you take two groups. So this part is a bit too much technical. Maybe I will not review this in too much details. So you take two finite groups, you take two three co-cycles. Okay. So this part is saying that the monoidal functor between these two monoidal categories are completely characterized by two maps. One map F is a group morphism between G1 and G2, and the other map is this is just a map satisfying such equation. So one equation, yeah. So I don't read the details, it's too technical, but you see, for this example, you can completely characterize a monoidal functor using some sense classical notion from group morphism or map satisfying some co-cycle relation or something like that. So it's just, in fact, it is just a reformulation in this context of the axiom of what is a monoidal functor. So it's an exercise. Okay. And we can note, if you denote this monoidal functor like that, depending on F and mu, now you can also characterize the natural monoidal transformation between two such monoidal functor. And so I will not go into the details of that, it's too technical, but it's more or less an exercise. Okay, so here we provide an example for the cyclic group of order n. Okay. So if you are interested in this, you can go to the slide to read it in detail, or you can go to the video or slide of the semester one, where everything is explained in more details than what is written in this slide. So okay. Now. what about group action on categories? So we know that a group can act on a set, can act on a vector space, but in fact, in this section, we will introduce the notion of action of a group on a category. And we will define the notion of equivalentization, which is something about the group action, about the group. So, okay, so you take a category. You take any category here and you consider monoidal category of this monoidal category of C, where the objects are the equivalence of category between C and itself, so auto-equivalence. The morphism are natural isomorphism, and the monoidal structure is just given by the composition. So you see a way to make a monoidal category from a category C, which is not assumed to be monoidal. So you just consider the, in fact, here the object are equivalence of category. So you see, you can play with this notion of you can take equivalence of category as an object and the natural isomorphism as morphism, etc. So you have a lot of liberty to make new monoidal categories. So it's a monoidal subcategory of AND of C, where the object morphism and monoidal structure are weaker here. We only consider functor, not equivalence. Here, we only consider natural transformation and not natural isomorphism. And the composition is the same for the monoidal structure. And okay. And you can even more you can restrict this monoidal category if C is also monoidal. Then you can put monoidal everywhere, monoidal natural transformation, monoidal equivalence, and you get a subcategory, a stronger, yeah, hot tensor C. Okay, now you consider, you take a group, you consider this category D, where the element, where the object are the element of the group, and the morphism are just so the morphism between two elements is the identity if they are equal, otherwise there is no morphism. So it's more or less very easy or very skeletal, if you want, category from G. So it's a monoidal category. The monoidal structure is given by the composition. And we will use it to define the action of a group on a category. So action of a group on a category C, or we will define action of a group on a monoidal category C. So it's given as a monoidal functor between this category KG and hot C that we defined before. So a monoidal functor. So these two categories are monoidal. So you can introduce monoidal functor. And if you want an action of G on a monoidal category C, so you do the same thing, but you consider this subcategory here where everything is taken monoidal. Okay. So what about that? That should be maybe the monoidal structure. So you want a monoidal functor, so you need a monoidal structure, and the monoidal structure is given like that. So you have the monoidal functor here, and this is the monoidal structure on this functor. So here, it's a tensor product on hot C, and here, this is a tensor product on 4G. So you really have monoidal structure as we defined yesterday. Okay. So now, the G equivariantization of a category. So you have a category and we will define a new category called G power C power G. So in this category called the G equivalentization of C. So C here should be assumed monoidal or not, I'm not sure, maybe not. Let's see. So the object of this new category are pairs. X is an object of C and U is a family of isomorphism like that. So TGX. What is TG? So T, I guess T is a monoidal functor. So you guess you assume to have this monoidal functor. You consider this monoidal functor. Okay. So you have a family like that. TGX to X. So such that you should have this commuting diagram. Okay. So let me check something. TG. Okay. So TG is so you assume TG is an auto equivalence between C and itself. So the functor. So wait, let me check something. Okay. So monoidal functor. Okay. So you have C. So you have the category C, and this is another category also. The TG, yeah, is a functor. Okay, so you have that. So you see, in fact, this commuting diagram encodes the regularity of this family with the action of the group. Because you see, you have the you apply this two times, and you get the GH via the monoidal structure. And so you have two, you have an ambiguity here, which is solved by assuming this diagram to commute. Okay. Okay. So what about, so this is the object. Now what about the morphism? So morphism between two such objects. So it's given by a morphism between the two objects of C together with this extra assumption. So you still have this ambiguity here to go from this to this. So it is solved by assuming that to commit. And so you have a natural, well-defined notion of morphism between these two objects. So of course, as before, if C is assumed to be monoidal, then you replace that by that to get a monoidal structure on this. So this is not assumed to be a monoidal category. But if C is monoidal, then you get a monoidal structure here by taking this instead of this. Okay. So, example. So if you take, so in fact, you see this construction is interesting because if you start from the trivial category, the category just of vector spaces, and you apply this construction, in fact you get the category of representation. So in fact, this action is just making the group acting on the object of the category. So the G equivariantization can be understood as making the group acting on the element of the category. So making the group acting on vector space is considering the category of representation of the group. But you see, it's very interesting because you can make the group act on something abstract, not necessarily a vector space. For example, you can make the group act, I don't know, on the category of tangle we defined before, I don't know, something completely general. You can take any object of a random category, and it makes sense to a group to act on this object, and it makes sense to consider the category of, in some sense, representation of this group on this object. Anyway, so this construction is very important. So you see, in fact, this infinite family of isomorphism can be think as you have, when you are in the category vector space, each element is a vector space. So this is just the matrix representation of this element on this vector space. So you have an infinite family like that. And this commuting diagram is just saying that the action is dealing well with the group multiplication. But this is much more general than just for vector space. Okay. So very interesting. So what about next? Monoel category. Okay. So something else. So new notion. A monoidal category is called strict if the associativity constraint is trivial. And the unit map is also trivial. So remember, we have this big pentagon axiom where involving the associativity and the unit constraint. So the associative constraint, you have the unit axiom involving the unit constraint. So it's non-trivial in general, but a strict monoidal category is defined as a monoidal category where the associativity constraints are all trivial, are all identity maps. Okay. So here are examples of strict monoidal category. Okay, so you take a category C and you consider what we defined before, the functor from C to itself as object, the natural transformation as morphism, and the composition as monoidal structure. This is a strict monoidal category. Okay. Another strict monoidal category, you consider this category called set bar, like that. The objects are the non-negative integer. The morphisms are just a map from this set to me. So it's just map. So any random map. And the monoidal structure, the tensor product, is just the multiplication. So you see, this is strict also. So it's more or less some trivial example of a strict monoidal category. Okay. So now you define, as we said, the tensor product is defined of the object, but also on the morphism. So how to define the tensor product on the morphism? So you take two morphisms, so two random maps between these two sets. And the morphism is defined, in fact, as you can expect, is a more natural way, like that. So you just have a set of M1, M2 element and a set of N1 and 2 elements. And the most natural way to compose these two function, to map, to get a set is like that. So it's very natural. Okay. So note that this set is monoidally equivalent to the usual monoidal category of set, of finite set. This is not the usual category of finite set because here it's strict. You have only one object for it's a skeletal also here. Sorry. In general, the category of set is not skeletal. So it's the usual one is not the same as this one, but they are monoidally equivalent. Okay. Same thing for the category of vector space. You can have two vector space which are equivalent, they are not the same, so it's skeletal, but you can make the analog of before, the vector bar like that for k vector space. Here, in fact, the objects are not vector space, but just as before, natural non-negative integer. The morphism are no more the map, random map, but matrix. So morphism between the two negative integers like that, it's a matrix, n cross n matrix. And the tensor product is also the multiplication like that. And so now the question is how to apply the tensor product on two matrix. And in fact, it's a very well-known construction called the Kronecker product. So if you have two matrix like that, you can make a matrix M1, M2 cross N1, N2 by the Kronecker product. And I guess I did not. Yeah, so it's well known. In fact, you have two matrix like that and one matrix. And in fact, you make the composition, you have a big, and you put like that, you fill, and here you make the coefficient. I don't go into the details, but it's very well-known construction. And it's the most natural way to make a tensor product of matrix. Okay. Again, they are monoidally equivalent to the usual category of vector space. Okay. So I guess we can do the same thing for the category of G-graded vector space, like that. But here, the objects are not the natural integer, but such a function, like that. Okay. This property, this finiteness property. Okay. So as a summary of this list of examples, most of the usual modal category, the set, vector space, G-graded vector space, etc., are non-strict, but they are monoidally equivalent to strict categories. And in fact, it's not it's true in general. And this is the first important result on monoidal category, Maclean strictness theorem. Any monoidal category C is monoidally equivalent to a strict monoidal category. So we call that strict is the associativity constraint and the unit constraint are trivial. They are identity. So you can always, for any monoidal category, monoidal category is more or less equivalent to a category where the associativity constraint are trivial. Okay. So in fact, you can, so I will not go into the details of that. So in fact, this was proved, of course, in full details in the first semester. Like the first semester, not the last semester, because I took the, see the first semester. So in the first semester, it was proved in full details. So in the review of last semester, I provided the idea of the proof. But for now, I will skip also the idea. In fact, you can see, you can understand the idea of the proof just by a non-categorical analogous involving monoid. So you see, a monoidal category is a categorification of the notion of monoid. So the notion of monoid is very easy to define. And in fact, the MacLane strictness theorem is just the categorification, the proof is just a categorification of this proof. Yeah, so it involves left multiplication like that, and in fact, in the category you have the left the functor of left tensor product, which is here, and this is we know that this is strict, and so the category equivalent, which will be a subcategory of that, able to represent every element of the category by the tensor product. Like that, left tensor product functor. And so it will be monoidal equivalent to a subcategory of this strict category. Exactly as when you make this for monoid or for group, you represent a group by acting a group on itself. It is exactly the same thing. So it's, yeah. So at the group or monoid level, it's more or less trivial. At the monoidal category level, the proof is non-trivial, but if you should check the proof, the details, we've done this in the semester one. Also in the, it's not in the book. It's not in the book tensor category, but it's in the, it should be in the, maybe it's in the book. I don't remember, maybe. Let me check. Let me check. It is in the book. M. MacLane strictness theorem, page 36. Yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, it is in the book. Yeah. As I said, on section 2.8 of the book. So you can both read the book or read the slide in first semester, etc. Okay. So what time is it? Let me check. Okay, it remains 15 minutes before the pause. Okay. So this, you should understand that MacLane strictness theorem is not, so the proof is non-trivial. The statement itself is non-trivial. Any monoidal category is always monoidally equivalent to a strict monoidal category, but is not isomorphic to. So you see, the notion of monoidally equivalent, or equivalence of category, is a weak version of isomorphism, monoidally isomorphism. So they are not always isomorphic. So the generic counterexample, you take a non-strict category, and you take the strict one coming from the MacLane strictness theorem, but they are monoid equivalent, but not isomorphic. Okay. So you should ask what's the point of considering monoidal categories which are non-strict, in fact, because you can always have something strict which is more or less the same. In fact, you can always strictify a monoidal category, but this strictification, so the strictification coming from MacLean, the proof of MacLean strictness theorem, this strictification add a lot and a lot of objects, which make, which is not so convenient in some case. For example, you consider this category of G-Golic vector space. It is a finite group. You take the three cocycle non-trivial. So it is not, this one is not isomorphic to a strict monoidal category. It is not. Okay. So is not strict, then it's not okay. Okay. So you can strictify it. So wait, let me check. Okay. So I don't want to go into the details of this stratification process, but in fact, what you should understand here is that the stratification process involves a free group. So even if you start from a finite group, when you want to stratify this, you should add a huge amount of new objects involving a free group. So a free group is an infinite group of exponential growth, so which is very, very big. So you see, you start from a finite group and the stratification involves such a big group. So in that sense, it's not so convenient to do that. In some cases, this depends on what you want to do. Okay. So this explains why we don't just consider strict categories. Now, you have a notion which is more or less the opposite of strict strictness is the skeleton. As we said here, strictify a category had a lot and a lot of objects, a lot of new objects. For example, you had a lot of objects which are isomorphic. Here, you see. A lot of objects which are isomorphic. The opposite is the skeleton is the skeleton of a category is that there is only one object. The category is skeletal if there is only one object for each isomorphism class. And you can also, any monoidal category is monoidal equivalent to a skeletal monoidal category. It's called skeleton. So it's more or less the opposite way. You have the strictification and the skeleton. If you are considering the number of objects, they are completely opposite. So what? So in practice, when you deal with, for example, fusion ring, it's more convenient to consider skeletal monoidal category, a skeletal fusion category, skeletal categorification by considering the Pentagon equation involving, algebraic equation. But in fact, we cannot, as I said, it's opposite process. And in general, you cannot both have strict and skeletal. in general, a monoidal category is not monoidally equivalent to a strict and skeletal monoidal category. So there are examples for which it's possible, but in general, it is not. So this this category with co-cycle has a strict skeleton if and only if the co-cycle is trivial. You consider the skeleton of that, and the skeleton of that is strict. If and only if this is trivial, and in fact, this is the proof is reduced to what to how we construct that. It's trivial. This was made to, yeah, by more or less by definition. In fact, except from this example with that trivial, so this example with that trivial is called pointed. We don't know much example of strict skeletal monoidal category. So I did not define yet what is a fusion category, but it's a categorification of the notion of fusion ring we introduce in the introduction. If you want to have a strict skeletal fusion category, then the multiplicity of the category should be one, which means that the multiplicity space. So if you want the integer in the fusion data are at most one, zero or one. In general, it can be more than one. So in a pointed category, it's always one. But if you take a category of representation of a non-commutative group, sometimes it can be non-one. For example, I don't know. You take maybe not a too small, maybe S3 is too small, but if you take A5, it's not of multiplicity one. The rep of A5 is not of multiplicity one. So it don't have a strict skeleton. It is not a monoidal equivalent to a strict skeletal category. Okay, so when you categorify the fusion ring, when you categorify the character ring of the group A5, then the associativity constraint, the solution of the pentagon equation must be non-trivial. You don't have a trivial solution of the pentagon equation. Okay. Okay. So here is the main consequence of MacLane's strictness theorem. The fact that every monoidal category is monoidally equivalent to a strict monoidal category is used to prove that we don't need much to care about the parenthesis when you deal with a tensor product. So more precisely, when you consider the tensor product with more than three objects, you need to care about associativity constraint, because you need to care about the parenthesis. For example, here you have the pentagon axiom for 1, 2, 3, 4. You have four objects. You make a tensor product, and you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 ways to make parenthesis. Okay, and we know that there is two ways to go from this parenthesization to this parenthesization. The pentagon axiom says that these two ways are the same morphism. They are the same morphism. The morphism G and F are the same. The MacLane strictness theorem is saying exactly the same thing for more than four objects. So you have more than four objects. I will not read it to the detail, but the idea is the following. You have more than four objects. You have one way to make parenthesization, another way to make parenthesization, and you have two ways to go from one parenthesization to another parenthesization using identities and associativity constraints. McLane theorem is saying, coherence theorem is saying that this, any way you are choosing to go from one parentization to another, provide you the same morphism. So you see the statement of the theorem is very easy to understand. So you don't need much to care about the parentization when you make computation in a monoidal category, because you know they are all isomorphic. The associativity constraints are isomorphism. And for example, if you are in a skeletal category, in fact, all these objects are the same, even if you can have non-trivial associativity constraints. You don't need to care about the parentheses because, it's okay. The two way to change the parentheses provides always the same morphism. Okay, so McLane's strictness theorem is saying that you can safely remove the parentheses in the computation. What I said, and this was proved also in some previous semester in details. So you should refer to semester one also. I prove that in full details. Okay. Okay. So let us introduce a new property, a new notion. So we talk about monoidal category. Our goal is the tensor category and then the fusion category. The first ingredient to join tensor category is rigid. So rigid is the categorification of the notion of inverse.
Wait a minute.
So we will explain that after the pause, but you should understand that the notion of rigid will is the categorification of the notion of inverse in a group, so monoid category, monoidal category. Categorification of the notion of monoid, rigid monoidal category, categorification of the notion of group, so a monoid with an inverse. Okay, so we will make the pause now. We start. So where is it? Okay, so rigid monoidal category, categorification of rigid categorifies the inverse. So here, the notion of inverse is given by the notion of dual. So we have two ways of making dual, left or right. So you consider a monoidal category. It's called rigid if every object admits a left a right rigid, a right dual. You can read in the literature if there are only left dual, so it's left rigid or it can be right rigid. But when it is both, it is just rigid. So what is a left dual of a dual, left dual of an object? So you consider an object, take an object X in a monoidal category. An object X star will be called a left dual if there is the following two morphism. One morphism is called evaluation morphism, and the other co-evaluation morphism. So it's a morphism from X star tensor X to the unit and a morphism from the unit to X tensor X star. Okay. So you can represent. So from now, we may represent some notion pictorially. So you have X. So a tensor product will be, you have two objects, X and Y. The tensor product will be represented like that. So here it's a tensor product. So this means an element of the home space, the home set X star tensor X 2, 1. Okay. And this so evaluation map can be represented also with like that. So you will see why later. We see why, in fact, just now, because to be a left dual, it should have these two morphisms, but also they should satisfy this relation. So this relation encode a way to go from X to X. In fact, to one tensor X to X tensor one, but as we said, we identify Y tensor X and X tensor Y with X. In fact, so you have a kind of ambiguity using the co-evaluation map and evaluation map. You can go from X to itself, a priori, non-trivially, using, a co-evaluation map and associativity constraint. You use the co-evaluation map here. So you make this new from nothing, from one. And here you have the associativity, you have identity. You apply associativity constraint to change the parenthesis. And you apply the evaluation map to reduce that to one. And okay, you can do the same in the other way. And you see in what sense these representations are very useful, because you can very easily represent this sequence of morphism like that. It's just, I will not go into the details, but you go from X to X. And in fact, this composition of identity, this is the assumption, which pictorially means that this is equal to this, or this is equal to this. This is a zigzag relation. Zigzag relation. So pictorially, yeah. Okay. So you have a kind of topological, you can deform topologically such a picture in the pictorial representation. So you cannot deform randomly any pictorial representation. You have to be careful, but you have to be really careful, but you really can do. So it's okay. So you can define the notion of right dual exactly as before. You have to be careful. So you should check the previous semester or the book to see the details of how to define the right dual. But a priori, the right evaluation map, you have a star here and no star here. And a star here and a star here, you are inverse or something like that. So dual, so you have to be careful. But the same idea. And okay. So you can connect the right and left dual. Wait a minute. Okay, the right and left dual like that. So if you have, you take an object X with a left dual, then X is a right dual of the left dual. This is how to read this equality. Or X is a left dual of its right dual. So it's a choice. You can choose X as the right dual. The left and right dual are not unique a priori. We will see maybe soon that they are unique up to some isomorphism, but they are not unique. Okay. So, and Also, the convention we made, so we don't need to care about the unit. The left dual, right dual of the unit is the unit itself. We make this identification. Okay. So here I recall some notion of adjoint of functor, in fact, because we need to understand that the notion of dual of an object, the dual functor, so there is a relation between the notion of dual and the notion of adjoint of the functor. So for that, we need to recall quickly the notion of adjoint of a functor in general, and then we will explain the relation between with the notion of a left and right dual of an object in the monoideal category. So you consider two locally small categories. So locally small, recall that, which means the collection of morphism between two objects are set. So you call that home set. You consider two functors, one between C and D, D and C, and the other between C and D, such that, so these two functors will be, we will provide a property, and this property will be the definition for them to be dual to adjoint to each other. So you assume two functors to satisfy this property. So there is a natural isomorphism, alpha x and beta y, like that, between these two functors, the forgetful functor. So you have this, so it's a bit technical, but you have this functor from the category D to set. We know it's locally small, so which means you put an element here. And what you get is a set. Same thing here. You put an element, you get a set. You put an element, you get a set. So this is a functor. This is a functor. It's a functor. It's a functor. And we define, you assume the existence of natural isomorphism between this functor and this functor, and this functor and this functor. Okay. So F. So here there is a mistake. Let me fix this mistake. Here it should be D. So F, you see, F is from D to C. So F here, this one should be in D. This is in C. So let me check again. This is in C. This is X, where is in C. This is in D. This is in D. So there should have a D somewhere because there is a symmetric problem. G, this is here, it's D. Here it's D. Okay. So we have a natural isomorphism between these two functors. So you can, so you are saying you are moving F, you are putting it here in this case and also in this case. Yeah, so this is exactly what I am saying here. So as long as you have that, these two functors F and G are called adjoint each other. F is called the left adjoint of G. G is called the right adjoint of F. And you can see this as the categorification or categorical analogous of the matrix adjoint. And in fact, this will make sense because in a fusion category, the left dual of an object, when you consider the fusion matrix, in fact, it is a matrix adjoint of the fusion matrix of the object. An object as a fusion matrix, and the left adjoint of this object has also a fusion matrix, which is the matrix adjoint. So the analogy between this construction, this notion, and matrix adjoint makes sense in that way. Okay. So now you consider, you assume that C equals D here, and you assume there are monoidal categories. Don't assume there are monoidal categories. You just take C equals D and you consider this monoidal category. I see. So here is a link between adjoint and dual. So in this category, monoidal category, the functors are the object. So it makes sense to talk about dual of an object here, as we defined before. Here, left dual and right dual C is monoidal category. Here, the monoidal category is that. So it makes sense to consider the functor of that as an object here and to consider the left dual. And in fact, the connection is F is a left adjoint of G as a functor defined before, if and only if F is a left dual of G as an object. So it's a So the notion of left dual covers the notion of left adjoint when you consider this specific monoidal category. So as you see, the notion of the adjoint of functor is a very, very deep and very, very studied notion in category theory. People which are doing algebraic geometry, they usually consider the adjoint of a functor or something like that. The notion of left dual, in fact, is even more general than the notion of adjoint. So it's very deep, very, very deep. So you have the same correspondence for the right adjoint and right dual. So what about this proposition? So you consider a monoidal category, you take an object, you consider one object with a left dual. So the category is not assumed rigid, you just take a monoidal category, you take one object having a left dual. This is what I said before. In fact, if one object admits a left dual as defined before with evaluation and co-evaluation map, then this left dual is unique up to isomorphism, and in fact, this isomorphism is unique also. So if you have another left dual, if you have one left dual and another left dual, then there is one isomorphism, and this isomorphism is unique. Like that. So you have an object. One left dual and another left dual, like that. Then you have an isomorphism between the two, and this isomorphism is unique. And in fact, so we prove that also in a previous semester. So I should write previous semester because at one moment we will go to semester two. I don't remember. So see previous semester. So the proof of that is absolutely non-trivial. In fact, we prove that that require, if we want to go into the full details, we prove that in require 7 slides. Okay. So now, a minute. Dual of morphine. So we define the notion of dual for object, but now we will define the notion of dual for morphism. And we will see, as you can see already, it will be very intuitive pictorially. So you consider two objects having left dual. You consider a morphism, and we want to define a morphism between the two left dual. In fact, it's a contravariant. It's a sense that you have a morphism from x to y, and then you get a morphism from y star to x star. So we will see later that the dual functor is contravariant because it reverses the arrow. It reverses the arrow. So how to define a morphism from y star to x star? In fact, there is a very, so you have f from x to y, an element of the Hom space between x and y. Using picture, it's very natural to define the morphism from y star to x star. You just apply evaluation and coevaluation map and some identities, and you get something picturally from y star to x star. And then you just have to write this. In fact, this picture makes sense. In fact, itself, this picture is well defined. But if you want to, you don't want picture, you can just translate this picture like that. So you involve co-evaluation map, evaluation map. And if even if you want to be careful about the associativity constraint, because in the picture we don't mention the associativity constraint. In fact, pictorially, the associativity constraint can be represented like that. You have two things, one thing, and you do like that. This is the picture for associativity constraint, because you see you have one parenthesis here, and then you have the parenthesis here. This is a picture for associativity constraint. But by Maclean's strictness, by Maclean's coherence theorem, in fact, you can, you don't need to care that much here. You just have three. Yeah. By Maclean's coherence theorem, you don't need to care about that. But if you want to write it purely algebraically without picture, you need to put parentheses and you need to put associative constraint, etc., etc. But you see, it's a very easy exercise to translate this picture into this. So you have a morphism from that to that. So be careful again. You use identification when you tensorize by one, you said it's the same thing that nothing. Okay, so we did that for left dual of a morphism, but you can have the same thing for a right dual of a morphism. You do like that. So the same idea. Okay. So this proposition saying that the monoidal functor preserves the left dual. So you take two monoidal categories. You consider a monoidal functor. So we define the monoidal functor only with a functor and a monoidal structure G. And we saw that this extra morphism, I guess it's a morphism, I don't remember the nature of this object, which pop up naturally. So you can consider it as a triple. This is a way done by Maclean, but in fact, in the book, they just consider it as a couple. In the definition of a monoidal functor, but at this step of the book, for this proposition, I take it as a triple because I guess we will use a phi in the proof. But in fact, here we don't We don't explain the proof in details. It was done also in some previous semester in details. So you have the monoidal functor from the two categories. And assume you have an object with a left dual, then like that. So you the left dual of f of x is f of the left dual of x. So you can move the star outside, or you can move it inside. So that was proved in details in some previous semester. You should refer to it if you want to know, or in the book. But monoidal functor preserve left dual, it deal naturally with left dual. Okay. Now, what about dual object and morphism? So you consider so how, what about the dual and composition and tensor product of morphism? So you have three objects having a left dual, and you consider morphism between this object. So I did not wrote the details, but you have a morphism between U and V and V and W, etc. You make a composition. And in fact, the composition, so the left dual of the composition of the morphism, you have to reverse, but you can put the star inside, but you have to reverse the order like that. And in fact, it's very easy to see pictorially. Same thing for the tensor product of object. The tensor product, you also reverse, you put inside, you reverse. Okay, so pictorially, it's like that. So you have a composition, you make the left dual, and you can see, you can move using the zigzag action, you can move this part here and this part here. And so you see, this is the left dual, this is the left dual, so you exactly get that. Same thing for the tensor product. You have U, V, W, like that. So you have it's a morphism between U tensor V to W. This morphism, you apply a star, the left dual, like that. You get a morphism between W star and V star. Wait. V star U star. Yeah, V star U star. Okay. And this kind of picture can be used as intuition to prove that algebraically also. Okay. In details. So now what about? So that was everything in this section was proved in details in some previous semester and in the book. So now what about natural adjunction isomorphism? Okay. So this is related to what we discussed about adjoint functor. So you consider monoidal category, an object with a left dual, and then you consider the functor of making a tensor product by V on the left. So you have this functor from C to C, and in fact, the functor of making a tensor product by the left dual of V is in fact the left adjoint of this functor. So the, again, a relation between dual and adjoint here. And so by the definition of what is a left adjoint, there is a natural isomorphism. Here it's called the natural adjunction isomorphism. between these two functors. And this can be written like that. In fact, you have V here. So where is the, on the left, on the right? So let me check. So you have V on the left, and then you can move it here like that. So what about alpha beta? So I made some picture. Yeah, okay. So alpha correspond to this picture, and beta here correspond to this picture. Okay. So an element in this Ohm space is represented by this picture. So the functor alpha, the natural isomorphism alpha is doing like that. You do that. You just do that, in fact. You don't need to care about that. This is just a separation. So you just do that, and you get a morphism from U to W tensor V star. Or beta, you start from here, and you do like that. Okay, and you come back here. Okay. So when you compose the two, beta alpha, you are just reduced to a zigzag relation. So the composition of that and that is the identity. So you get natural isomorphism. Okay. So this is I spoke too much about that. Okay. So an object is called rigid if it has a left and a right dual, and as we defined at the beginning, the category is rigid if all its objects are rigid. So example, you consider the monoidal category of vector spaces, but you need to assume to be finite dimensional, because otherwise you cannot have the rigidity property. But you have to be careful, you need finite dimensionalness, because otherwise there is no co-evaluation map. There is no co-evaluation map for an infinite dimensional vector space. So you take a finite dimensional vector space over a field. The left and right dual are defined. The usual dual space of a vector space defined by linear form are left and right dual. They can be used by this evaluation and co-evaluation map. So in fact, when you talk about linear form, something acting on the vector space and providing you a scalar. So you have a linear form, a vector, and you get a scalar. So this is exactly an evaluation map. And to get the co-evaluation map, in fact, you need to use so you need to consider a basis of V and the dual basis of V star. And you consider this sum, and in fact, this sum is independent. So it's a theorem, it's a well-known theorem of algebra that this sum is independent of the choice of the basis. So the dual basis is just a linear form, and when you apply here, you get some Kronecker symbol, etc. 0, 1. 1 if I equal j, and 0 if I different from j, etc. etc. So you get two, there is two natural ways to get evaluation, co-evaluation map. And in fact, it's a trivial exercise to check the zigzag relation here, because here everything is more or less trivial. The associativity constraint is trivial, etc. Okay, so this usual notion of dual space is a dual in the sense of category. So the category of finite dimensional vector space is rigid. And you see here why, for in the infinite dimensional case, you cannot have a problem, because here, in the infinite dimensional case, you you may, you should, you you would have an infinite sum, which make a problem. That's why. Okay, so now what about the rigid structure on the category of representation of a group? So again, we need finite dimensional representation for the same reason. So you take the dual as before, but the point we need to check, or you need to clarify here, is how, okay, you have the right dual, left dual in the sense of vector space, but it's in this category. So how the group acts on the dual? And in fact, it acts on the dual by this formula. So so here, this is a representation. Here is the dual space, the group. So this is what we want to define. What is the matrix representing the element G on this dual vector space? It is just the matrix adjoint of the inverse of G on the vector space V, acting on V. So this is how G acts on V star. Okay. Now, another example of rigid monoidal category. Let me check the time. So it remains 10 minutes. 10 minutes. So we can define, as I said, the notion of rigid monoidal category categorifies the notion of group, as the notion of monoidal category categorifies the notion of monoid. In fact, if you consider the category of graded vector space on a monoid, it is rigid if and only if the monoid is a group. So this is a canonical, the easiest non-trivial example of a monoidal category, graded vector space. It's a canonical way to make a model of a monoid in a monoidal category framework, and it's rigid if and only if, in fact, it's a group. In fact, so the dual involves the inverse, and you see, in fact, the evaluation and co-evaluation map is just taking the tensor product, is just the the multiplication here, so just identity, everything is identity, is completely trivial. Completely trivial here. Okay. So you can also get a rigid structure when you deform by a supercycle, but you have to be careful. The evaluation co-evaluation map here should be modified using the supercycle, that should need a renormalization. Okay, but it's an exercise. You just need to check. You need to see where and how you should put this constant, and everything should be okay. Okay, so now dual versus opposite category and rigidity. So what about that? Okay. So there are two notions. So you have to be careful. There are two notions people can can make mistake that these two notions, dual and opposite, are distinct. Oh, sorry. That is like that. So you should not merge these two notions. So what is these two notions? So you consider a monoidal category with left dual. So as we said before, it's left rigid. Okay. So this functor, the dual functor, mapping object to dual object, left dual, morphine to left dual morphism, is contravariant, which means that you reverse zero, the contravariant functor. Otherwise, when the functor do not reverse zero, it's called covariant. And it induces a monoidal functor between the dual category and the opposite category, which are not the same. But there is a monoidal functor given by the dual. So the dual category is just the category C where you reverse every arrow. And the opposite category is the category C, same arrow, but you just reverse the tensor product. So here the difference is at the level, monoidal level. Here the difference is at the morphism level. You reverse the arrow. Okay. And so you deduce from that when you apply two times the dual functor, what you get is a monoidal covariant functor from C to C. So if C is monoidal, is rigid monoidal category, then these two categories are monoidally equivalent. And this makes the double dual functor an auto-equivalence between C and itself. And the quasi-inverse of this auto-equivalence, so remember the notion of equivalence, you have F and G, such that the composition is a natural, I don't remember, natural isomorphism with identity, natural transformation, natural isomorphism with identity. So if you have the F, you need the G. The G is called the quasi-inverse. The quasi-inverse here is the double right dual. Okay. Okay. But you have to be careful that because this is an auto-equivalence, I guess, if I'm not mistaken, no. But anyway, so you should be careful that in general, the left dual of an object is not isomorphic to the right dual of an object. In general, they are not isomorphic. So we will see later some result stating that some extra assumption making the double dual is always isomorphic to X. So this is when we will talk about pivotal category. So we will mention the double dual and the object itself. Okay, so pivotal category will be an extra assumption to tensor category, or maybe it can be defined directly to monoidal category, I don't remember. But anyway, that will come very soon, not today, but next week, I guess. Now, consider two rigid monoidal categories, two monoidal functors, then a natural transformation between two monoidal functors must be a natural isomorphism. So that very strong property in the rigid case, which is not true if it is not rigid, any natural transformation between monoidal functors of rigid monoidal category are natural isomorphisms. But very strong. Okay. So that was the end of the review of the chapter about monoidal category. And we can now start the chapter about tensor category. So in the last 3 minutes, I will just try to explain this. So a multi-tensor, and I will come back to that next week because otherwise it will be difficult to follow. So I will define, in fact, here, I provide here the full definition of what is a tensor category using some notion which will be defined later. So this definition is put it here to motivate all this notion we will introduce after that. And once when we will have defined all this notion, then we will redefine tensor category. So we will not use a notion of tensor category. Now, I just put the definition to motivate this new notion we will introduce very soon. But so I will restart from here next week. Okay, because I have no time now. Notion of locally finite, k-linear, abelian, indecomposable, finite sum, etc. Finite, semi-simple, etc. So this is what we are interested most, is notion of fusion category. Yeah. And here we will explain, in fact, the correspondence. In fact, we already did that very quickly in the introduction, the correspondence between all these axioms for a fusion category, so all these properties, et cetera, of for defining a fusion category are encoded in the algebraic, are already present here. For example, rigid correspond to dual for fusion ring. Pentagon axiom, unit axiom correspond to that, etc. K-linear correspond to Frobenius reciprocity. Semi-simple correspond to, there is such a sum, always decomposition. Finiteness correspond to finite basis, etc. Okay, so let me check the time. If I'm not mistaken, it is time to stop.